Hello, welcome everybody. Thank you for joining the Culture and Nature Festival Multilingual Online Snorkeling. My name is Ben from the Port Phillip EcoCentre. It's great to have you here today. And first things first, what we'd like to do is acknowledge the traditional owners of the Boonwurrung and Wurundjeri peoples of the Kulin Nation and recognize the continuing connection to land, waters, and culture. We pay our respects to the elders past, present, and emerging, and that the land was never ceded. So just a couple of housekeeping things before we do start this. What we need to ask is if there are participants on the Zoom that just to stay muted, you can ask questions via the Q&A tool located right at the bottom and make sure that your chat function is off for all participants. And for those listening in Mandarin audio, download the Interprefy app. That's Interprefy app and enter the token Snorkel CNF 2021 and select audio. This webinar will also be recorded on EcoCentre's YouTube channel, EcoCentre TV. And there are plenty more events. There's a whole medley of things that we're going to be doing throughout the rest of the week and over the next few days. And if you are interested, go to ecocentre.com/CNF2021. So there's a few people to introduce here. We have our tech person, Reiko, who is responsible for doing everything that you see in front of you. So hello, Reiko. You're behind the scenes, but I know you can see us, but we can't see you. There's also Pham here. Pham is a marine biologist. And then Pham, can you tell us who you are in less than 100 words?
Sure can, Ben. Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Pham Charko. I am the marine biologist for the Port Phillip EcoCentre, and I'm very much looking forward to talking to you about the beauty of Port Phillip Bay.
I'm very excited as well. And for those of you who don't know me, my name is Ben. I am an educator at the Port Phillip EcoCentre as well, where I've worked there for the last 3 years. I'm also a paleontologist. I work on the marine fauna that used to live within Port Phillip Bay. It is all kinds of exciting. We're going to be discussing a lot of it. Fam, would you like to get started with this one? I believe you have a presentation that you can show everyone today.
Yeah, sure thing. So everyone, I'm just going to share my screen and enjoy the presentation. Just bear with me for a second while I get started. Okay. Here we go. So you may hear from my accent that I am not Australian. I wasn't born here. I am Dutch and I have been in Melbourne for the last 10 years only. So I grew up in the Netherlands and I put it on the world map for you there to see where I'm from. It's in that tiny, tiny little country in the northwest of Europe. And in 2011, I moved to Australia because I am a marine biologist and I love the marine life that we have out here in Australia, which is very special. So I made this really big trip and landed in Melbourne and eventually got to work at the EcoCentre here in St Kilda in Melbourne. Now, I am also a scuba diver and a snorkeler, which is why I'm so excited to speak with you about snorkeling today. And this is kind of the snorkeling and diving that I was used to when I still lived in the Netherlands. This is a photo of scuba divers in the North Sea, which is the sea between England or the United Kingdom and the Netherlands. And most of the time when I would go diving, it would look pretty much like this. So I was pretty unhappy doing my dives there because the conditions were very, very bad most of the time and quite challenging, and not to mention pretty cold as well. I prefer water like this. This is me on a holiday in Bali, and you can see I have not donned my wetsuit for this one because the water was nice and warm there, and you can see there's beautiful colors of coral underneath me and wonderful visibility. So this is the kind of snorkeling that I like to do. Luckily for us in Port Phillip Bay, most of the time we get conditions like this. And so I can't wait to get into the bay whenever I have the chance, whether it be scuba diving or snorkeling like this without the big tank on my back. diving here and snorkeling in Port Phillip Bay is actually world-class diving. And I've been everywhere all over the world diving in different conditions and different countries and different reefs and ecosystems. And Port Phillip Bay is still one of my favorite places. So I'll tell you a little story about actually the first dive ever that I did in Port Phillip Bay. So I was diving underneath a pier. In this case, it was Rye Pier down at the Mornington Peninsula. And I didn't really know anything about diving in Port Phillip Bay or the marine life that we could find there. Because in Port Phillip Bay, about 85% of the marine life that lives there lives nowhere else in the world. So I didn't know any of the animals and the plants down there. And so it was all kind of a big adventure for me. I didn't recognize any of them. It was like meeting a whole bunch of new friends, right? And so I was diving there and I saw a really nice crab on the seafloor, and I wanted to go and take a closer look. So I went down and I hovered right above the surface, right above the sand, so I could have a closer look at this small crab that was just beneath me. And what people didn't tell me, though, before I got into the bay, is that the bay actually has really big stingrays. They're completely harmless. They're very friendly, but they are pretty much as big as your dining room table. And what I didn't realize is that those stingrays really love eating crabs. So as I was looking through my snorkel mask, right, I had my mask on like this, looking down at this crab, I couldn't see anything out of the sides of my mask. This big stingray swept underneath me like a magic flying carpet and gobbled up the crab that I was just trying to watch. So that was a little bit of a shock, but very quickly I realized that those stingrays are pretty friendly. And Reiko here, who is doing the tech, actually shot a really beautiful video of one of these big stingrays on one of the dives that her and I did together on the Rye Pier. So Reiko, can you please show our audience the wonderful video that you took today? Here we go. So there it comes. We're just hovering under right here. And this wonderful southern stingray just coming to have a look at us. So that's me in the frame, and I'm giving the okay sign. So there's a little taste of the experience that Reiko and I had with this beautiful stingray, and certainly unforgettable for a diver and snorkeler like me. And the good thing is you don't have to go scuba diving to see these stingrays, because they hang around the piers all the time, which is wonderful. So even when you go snorkeling and you stay at the surface, or even if you just go and look over the edge of the pier, you don't even have to get wet to see them swim around, which is really fantastic. Thank you for that, Reiko. So very quickly, I also realized that there were plenty of other animals in the bay. Sorry, let me just fix up my screen sharing here so we can keep doing what we're doing. So very quickly, I realized that there were so many interesting animals in Port Phillip Bay. And these photos were taken by my good friend, Matt Testoni, who is a fantastic underwater photographer. And he consented to us using these wonderful photos that he took of creatures in the bay for this presentation today. So thank you, Matt. So what you see here is just a little taste of all the different animals that are living in our bay. So on the top left-hand side, you see a Port Jackson shark. Now, don't freak out when I say shark. These sharks are actually very friendly. They're very small and docile, and they would never hurt a human being. And it's actually really beautiful to see them stay on the bottom like that. On your right-hand side, on the top, you'll see an Australian fur seal. We have lots of seals living in the bay. There's a small colony that lives in the middle of the bay that you can also go and visit by boat with a tour operator, and you can even go and snorkel with them too. So there's an adventure for you to plan when you want to go out snorkeling. On the bottom left is our marine emblem of Victoria, the weedy sea dragon. This is a type of, it's related to a seahorse. And this animal here is why divers and snorkelers from all over the world are coming to Port Phillip Bay to dive here, specifically to see this wonderful animal. And on the bottom right-hand side, you see one of the most common residents of our bay, which is a globefish. And they always look this cute. They have these big bubbly eyes. They're very curious. They're not very scared. So you can swim up to them quite closely and have a closer look. And I love them because it just looks like they're always smiling at you. So these are a few creatures that I befriended on my adventures in the bay over the last few years. Now, because I like swimming in the bay and snorkeling and diving, and I spend so much time there, for me, it is also very important that I help protect this area that I love so much, because we are 5 million people in Metro Melbourne alone that live right on the shores of Port Phillip Bay. And that's a very unique situation and not always that great for the water quality or the animals who live there. So I like to help the bay as well as enjoying the creatures. On the left-hand side, you see me with my scuba diving gear on, and I'm holding a plastic bag with squid jigs that have been lost by fisher people who are on the pier fishing. Sometimes they lose their gear and it falls into the water. And what happens is that it just litters the sea floor with plastic, basically. And plastic is a really terrible thing to have in the marine environment because animals might accidentally eat it because they think it's food, and it's very bad for their health, and it can kill them, it can entangle them. So what I like to do is pick up the rubbish from the seafloor when I'm there and then get it out of the water and put it in the bin where it belongs. And on your right-hand side, you see me and Reiko snorkeling and engaging in the annual fish count that is organized by our friends from the Victorian National Parks Association a few times a year, where divers and snorkelers, anyone can sign up and you can go snorkeling in the bay and count the particular types of fish that you see. And with that, we help keep track of which fish are in which locations and which are spotted. And so we can help track of the health of the populations of all of these different fish species and make sure that we protect them for the future generations and our children and our children's children to enjoy as well in Port Phillip Bay. So those are a few activities that I still really like to do when I go out there. So if you're going to go out there and enjoy this beautiful marine life, also have a think about what you can do to help protect those beautiful ecosystems that we like to visit so much. Now, if this has inspired you and you want to go out snorkeling, there are a few places in Port Phillip Bay that are quite easy to get to and are also quite easy to go and snorkel if you're a beginner. So there's a few different arrows pointing at a few different reserves. The one that is pointing to Point Cook, that is Point Cook Marine Sanctuary. You can go snorkeling there and see all kinds of wonderful things like sea stars, toadfish, sea grasses, and all kinds of beautiful shellfish that live there on the reefs. It's very shallow. The one that is pointing up north to Port Phillip, that is actually in Williamstown. It's called Jawbone Marine Sanctuary, which is a wonderful marine sanctuary where you can go to see some larger fish every now and then, like morwong. And they have beautiful reefs and seagrass beds. And if you're lucky, you can see the very elusive little pipefish that looks just like a seagrass blade. So you have to look really, really closely because it's so well camouflaged to see if you can spot those little pipefish that look just like the seagrass. Then there is an arrow that's pointing to Beaumaris, and I'm sure that Ben will be talking a little bit about that area in his presentation. Exactly. That's Ben's local snorkeling spot over there. There is a marine park there that's called Ricketts Point Marine Sanctuary, and that is a place where you can go and see the more rocky reefs and the creatures that live there, including corals, cold water corals, including Port Jackson sharks, friendly ones, obviously, all kinds of beautiful fish and wonderful marine life in general. And the one that is pointing all the way down south at the bottom of the screen to the word rye, that is Rye Pier. And that's where you can go and see those beautiful stingrays and all kinds of wonderfully colorful sponges. Every now and then you might even get lucky and spot a weedy sea dragon, but also beautiful creatures like seahorses you can spot there on a regular basis. So I can really recommend trying out any of these spots. If you are a beginner snorkeler or if you have never snorkeled before, I can recommend you look up commercial dive and snorkel operations that are mostly down there on the Mornington Peninsula and just get some snorkeling lessons. Get a professional to teach you in a snorkeling class so you can get some basic skills and keep yourself safe and enjoy the bay for all that it has to give. Thanks everyone. I'll hand over to you, Ben.
Thanks, Farm. It was really great, that presentation. There was a question that came up. One person asked, where can we go to see the seals?
Ah, that's a very good question. The seals actually live in the middle of the bay. There is a man-made structure there called Chinaman's Hat, which is basically a wooden structure that looks like a very old school Chinese pointed hat. And that's where the seal colony is. So if you want to go and visit them, the best thing to do is to go with a commercial dive boat operator. There are a few that that run from Sorrento and Portsea. So you can Google seal colony Mornington Peninsula. And that will, so you can see then there will be a few different operators that will do tours there. And that's a really great way of going to see the seals, because you'll be there on a boat and there will also be a marine educator on that boat to tell you all about the seals and how they live and why they are there while you're looking at them. And then there are some operators as well that will allow you to snorkel with the seals, because they're actually quite playful, especially the baby ones. And it's really lovely to be out in the water there with them and see them from up close. And if you're lucky, they might even let you play with them as well.
They are so cute, Farm. They are just ridiculous.
The cutest,
aren't they?
Yeah.
They're little whiskers and they're so fluffy. You could almost die, seriously.
Yes, just adorable. Yes.
Awesome. Well, thank you for that presentation, Farm. What I might do is start my presentation now as well about my experience with the bay. So I might share my screen right now just to give you guys an idea of what I've had the chance to see. And I have a very different perspective from most people as well when it comes to actually doing this. So I'm going to just press from beginning. We've done that one already. Fantastic. So one thing that I really wanted to get across today with what we're seeing is Port Phillip Bay, as Fam had discussed before, is incredibly diverse. There are so many different habitats. There are reefs, often covered with algae, and these gorgeous sponges. There's these coastal shores where you tend to go swimming with your family, the rocky surfaces between the upper and lower reaches of the tide, the soft substrates. They look like deserts. They look like plains where there is no life whatsoever, but there's an incredible amount of diversity just underneath the surface. Seagrass meadows, amazing seagrasses, some of the few flowering plants that exist in salt water. Then, of course, there are the sponge gardens. Oh, Fam, you've seen those sponge gardens before. They're fabulous, aren't they? Oh, so pretty. The area that I really like in particular, though, is the open water. That's where you can see some really large animals like the smooth ray that you saw before. Sure, they come underneath piers and pylons as well. They tend to go around areas like the soft substrates, but they're so massive. You don't appreciate their true absolute size. And Fam touched on it a little bit, but there are sharks in Port Phillip Bay. So when I was younger, I was really interested in looking and trying to get out to the last refuge of wilderness. And I always saw that as being Port Phillip Bay. I grew up in Port Phillip Bay as a kid. I was always interested by marine life, specifically sharks and whales. I always wanted to understand more about them. So when I was younger, I used to go spearfishing all the time. I used to try and get flathead and snapper and brim, all these other species. And I found that there are these intricate food webs that occur in Port Phillip Bay. And they start with the tiniest dinoflagellate looking creatures you could possibly imagine. Tiny algal creatures that are floating in the seawater itself that are in turn eaten by zooplankton. The zooplankton are in turn eaten by anchovies, eaten by penguins. And I know I can't pronounce penguin at all. Butcher it every single time. I think I butchered your name a few times too, Farm. I'm very sorry for that, for the record as well. The penguins are in turn eaten by the seals. And of course the seals, as you might expect, that we did talk about before, are eaten by some of the top trophic predators. The largest is a variant that does come into Port Phillip Bay every now and again, the great white shark. 6 meters in length, 2 metric tons. They are not common in the bay. They are seasonal residents that come by every now and again. But it's really remarkable, the amount of diversity that you can see here. But there was one shark that I really wanted to talk about that really fascinated me for a very long time. And when I started working with places and institutions like the museum, they told me of the history that used to live in Port Phillip Bay beforehand. And it was the past that really intrigued me. There was one shark in particular that I thought had a really sad story to tell. And it's the one that you can see on the screen right now. It's the gray nurse shark, also known as the ragged tooth shark. They used to live in Port Phillip Bay and had probably been along the coastline for an excess of over 30 million years. We know that because we find their fossils dating back to that time. And even though you may look at them and they look like a ravenous predator, and they are, they have no interest in human beings whatsoever. They have these jagged teeth projecting from the bottom of their jaws, but they use them to eat slippery fish. They do not use them to eat us. But when Europeans came to the continent and first interacted with this animal, they saw this creature and just assumed that it was a man-eater. They didn't care to research this animal and understand its anatomy, understand that it was something known as a piscivorous shark, a shark that likes to eat fish, maybe even other sharks, maybe even stingrays, but not us. We placed a bounty on its head, and unfortunately, you will no longer be able to find this remarkable creature in the bay anymore because we systematically eradicated it. The last sighting in Port Phillip Bay was in the 1970s. You will never again get the chance to see a gray nurse shark in the state of Victoria. There are still some that exist within New South Wales and Queensland and even Western Australia as well. But that's it. There's not many of them around whatsoever. So learning about stories like this, connecting to the past, made me want to understand what used to be here. Why don't we see the same level of diversity today? So I also worked as a paleontologist for a number of years at the Melbourne Museum, and I was fascinated with one specific area. Fan pointed it out on the map, Beaumaris. And it's a remarkable deposit that dates back roughly 5 to 6 million years. And it's there that you can find fossils of some of the largest predators the world has ever seen. And I wanted to share this next slide with you. This is a tooth that I found. Everyone might know the megalodon. It's very famous because it appeared in a 2018 film with Jason Statham where he tried to take it on with a spear gun. How he won is anyone's guess. No idea in the slightest. But we
did
found
you like
evidence.
That film, Ben?
Oh, hated that film so much. It was so frustrating to watch. It couldn't exist in the Mariana Trench. It's just impossible. There's no way. So, you know, we'll play along with the film. It made it sure that everyone knew what the megalodon was, and it really did exist. It was the largest shark that ever existed. A creature that was 15 meters in length, weighing 50 metric tons, the same size as an adult humpback whale, the largest shark that ever existed. Some of the only things we find of it are its teeth, and that's it. So that tooth that you can see at the bottom there, I was privileged enough to find that tooth. It turns out to be one of the absolute biggest ever found on the continent. I'll tell you the story. In 2018, we found a completely new site unknown to science in the Bayside area in the southeast suburbs of Melbourne, about 30 minutes away from the center of Melbourne itself. And I was with my colleagues and we'd been snorkeling and free diving all day, holding our breath and swimming down to the bottom of the seafloor, trying to find fossils of animals that dated back to 5 to 6 million years. And I remember it was on the 14th of November, 2018. The sun was starting to set in the horizon. The water was as flat as a tack. And I said to all my colleagues around me, let's go out. Let's give one more effort. Let's see what we can find. If we find nothing at all, that's perfectly fine. We've done everything we can. But if we find something, we'll know it'll be special. So we all get out there. We swim over and I say, do you see the pinnacle over to the far right, 200 meters away? We're going to swim as far as we possibly can. So we start swimming over to the pinnacle. Can you guess what we found? Nothing. We found absolutely nothing. And I was a bit defeated and I was like, oh, well, we'd had a really good day already. We'd found some sperm whale teeth, you know, the usual kind of thing. And I decided to swim back in the shallows. And at about 100 meters in, I saw something out of the corner of my eyes. It was this dense contortion of bone sticking out of the sands. So I held my breath, dove underneath the water itself, got closer to this dense bone, got my gloved hand and wafted the water and the grit away from it. There, blue glinting enamel, serrated edge, just like a steak knife. I knew immediately what it was and I went to go pick it up with my hands. And the tooth that I picked up was the tooth that you can see there. The history of Port Phillip Bay and the surrounds of Victoria in some of the most remarkable fossil deposits anywhere in the world. Some of the absolute largest predators of all time. And the way in which I have to find it is to go snorkeling and to hold my breath. And that's what makes it so exciting. So Farm has a very different perception of what Port Phillip Bay is for her than what it is to me. I view it through a lens of absolute deep time. And I think it's very, very exciting. So I noticed we did get a question just then in there. And Farm, you might be able to answer some of this as well. I don't want to take up the entire time. Question's intriguing. Has anyone considered reintroducing grayner sharks into Port Phillip Bay? Farm, do you have any idea why that might be the case? Or would you like me to take this question?
I'm not sure, actually. It's a really good question to ask because they were fished out in so quickly, really. But there's a lot that goes into reintroducing an extinct species into the ecosystem again. I mean, first of all, Ben, and you can weigh in on this as well. I mean, they would have to come from somewhere. We would have to breed them. But we would also have to make sure that if we reintroduce them, that they could actually live a good and viable life in the bay immediately straight from the start. Now, Ben, do you have any information on if these gray nurse sharks were specialized for life in the bay, or were they exactly the same species as the ones we find up north in warmer waters?
It's hard to say because all we really have are pictures and a few jaws and teeth of individuals. So saying how much of a difference between those individuals from Port Phillip Bay to the rest is very hard to say. Presumably, they are the same in species that was occurring all across southern Victoria and into the reaches of New South Wales and Queensland. But I also think it comes down to fundamental notions of their anatomy as well. And grayner sharks do this really disgusting thing, and it's wonderfully disgusting by the same token. They practice something called intrauterine cannibalism. And it really is as gross as it sounds. There will be about 6 or 7 pups inside the female's uterus at any given time. And unfortunately, by the end of that gestation period, there will be only one left. And that's it.
That's brutal.
That baby will eat all of its brothers and sisters in the womb. And it takes the female a long time to recover from this. It might take her up to about 2 years. So those issues with gestation means that we can't get as many grayner sharks as we would hope. So if you take a really large population out from that habitat, reintroducing them is going to be very difficult because we just don't have enough to be bred around, like there's no tomorrow. They're a very difficult shark in order to breed. It also made me think of the next question, Fam, that had been asked to us a few times. And that question was, what is the scariest encounter that you've had in Port Phillip Bay?
In the bay. I think I don't really get that scared when I dive in the bay
That's
because
fair.
yeah, because you know the animals who live in the bay, just as most animals who live in the marine environment anyway, there's no, they are not dangerous unless you poke them, grab them, squeeze them, or drive them into a corner where they feel like they need to defend themselves. So, in the sense of marine life or encountering marine life, I don't really have any that scary stories. However, what is a consideration when you dive in the bay, or if even when you're snorkeling in the bay, is that it's not always. It doesn't always have the beautiful visibility that you see in the photos and that you saw in the video that I just showed. So for me, one of the, I guess the more nerve-wracking experiences I've had was where the visibility of the dive was not very good. So we couldn't see very far ahead. And it also means that you can get disoriented quite quickly. And this is more of an issue when you're a diver and you're actually under the sea and you can't just stick your head up and look around to see where you are. So when you're snorkeling, it's a little different because you can see the shore and you can put your head up and reorientate yourself. So I think the scariest situation I've been in was yeah, when I completely got disoriented underwater because the visibility was quite bad and there was a current that was picking up as well. And I was really trying to stay with my buddy, you know, and make sure that we didn't lose each other. Now, luckily, we were able to solve that situation because we have navigational equipment underwater as well. But just to be in the water column and not have any point of reference around you, you don't know like how where the bottom is, you don't know where, you know, how far the surface is, and you're trying to keep an eye on your buddy so you don't lose each other. Yeah, that disorientation was pretty challenging at that moment. Thankfully, when you're training to become a diver, you do learn how to deal with these kinds of situations. And so we were able to stay calm and breathe and take a minute and just recalibrate ourselves by looking at our equipment and our compasses underwater. And yeah, we were able to solve that situation. But yeah, it's pretty interesting to be in the water column without any point of reference, like being in the big blue and you don't know what's out there. It's kind of spooky.
It's a really intriguing question, though, because for me, it all comes back to training. And when it comes to, I've done a lot of diving in the past before, and as I know that you have as well, Farm, it all comes back to relating it back to previous experiences that you've had and being able to deal with them in a relevant occupational health and safety standard kind of matter. So for me, whenever I do feel like I'm at risk, I just don't go out in the water. I look at the weather reports. I make sure that I know the tides and the swell are doing the right thing. For me, the most dangerous thing that is in the water are people on jet skis. They can be more
Oh,
erratic
yes.
than, sharks that would come by. And we do get occasional big shark species coming into the bay. There was a report of a hammerhead coming past Black Rock only a month ago. So weird occurrences like that are becoming more and more frequent, but we don't really pose that much. They don't really pose as much of a threat as people think. As long as you leave them alone, they really don't have any interest in you whatsoever. Jet skis, though, boy, they do scare me an awful lot, as you would too, Farm.
Yeah, and they should because you know we have had instances where jet skis have hit divers and ignored the dive flags that divers bring with them to signify. So these are like big sausage-like buoys or dive flags that are blue and white flags that are bobbing on the surface. If you see one of those when you're ever on a boat or a jet ski, go around them with a very wide berth because it means that there's divers underneath who could come and surface at any moment. I think we have a few more questions in the Q&A.
Yes, we do. So, are those big stingrays common in the bay and are they friendly? And Farm, you go for it. You have fun with this
Yes.
question.
Yes and yes, double yes. So the big stingrays or the southern smooth rays that you saw in the video, they are very common in the bay. And they, some of them are actually so friendly that they will come up to divers and just kind of like check you out and then swim away again, like you could see in the video. They also love coming in around the piers, especially when the fishing boats come back in and there is a chance of a snack being thrown overboard by people. So often around sort of like the 1 p.m., 2 p.m. mark, you'll see them come into Rai Pier, just kind of like waiting, hanging around the pier, waiting for fishing people to come in with their boats. They are friendly. Again, as long as you keep your distance and you behave well in the marine environment, which means, you know, you don't chase animals, you stay calm, you don't touch anything. So if you behave like that, you can see them from up close. And yes, they're very friendly. I would go as far to say as that some of those rays are actually mates with some of the divers I know, and many of them have names. There's a very famous one that's called Stumpy because he doesn't have a tail anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's massive. He's about 2 meters across. Like, he's just the biggest boy you'll ever see. And then there's another one that is actually an albino. So it's a white one too, who's quite famous and likes to come in around. I think, yeah, she goes between Blair Gowrie and Rye a lot, I think.
She does, yeah.
Yeah, so a lot
amazing
of these
coloration.
A lot of these smooth stingrays are very much loved by the dive community, and it's always really lovely to see them and say hello to them. So yes, they're quite friendly, as long as you don't step on them or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, it is very important to acknowledge the fact that they do have that barb on the ends of their tail that can be about 40 centimeters in length. It's serrated in such a way that if it does ever penetrate flesh, it does more damage if you actually take it out in the other direction. So they are venomous as well. And if they ever do feel threatened with your presence, what they'll do is they'll actually arc their tail over their back, just like a scorpion will, to say, piss off. Don't come near me whatsoever. And you know to back away. But in the decade that I've been snorkeling in Port Phillip Bay, I've never had an issue with one of these creatures. And I'm in the water a lot, at least once a week, all the time, looking for fossils, looking for marine life. And I've never had a single issue with one of these creatures.
I'll tell you a funny story about one of these stingrays that I've observed once. So I was working as a dive instructor in the bay for a little while, and I was taking some students on one of their first dives underneath Rye Pier. And we were watching this beautiful, big, smooth stingray kind of like, you know, floating around the pylons. And the funny thing was, there was an underwater photographer that was taking photos of marine life under the pier. He was also scuba diving, and he was fiddling with his camera, and he was like trying to zoom in on a crab in the sand. And this stingray comes over and basically just kind of hovers above this man and starts gobbling up all of the air bubbles that the diver was breathing out and that were floating to the surface. And it was so funny to watch, because this stingray, I don't know why they do it, but it's almost like they're just like taking an extra big breath of oxygen, and he was gobbling it up through his mouth and then letting it flow out of his gills again, just to get that extra oxygen in. And this diver, and
it's
I was
surreal.
Watching, and I was like, oh my God, if this man looks up and he sees this massive stingray, he's going to freak out. But he didn't, because he was a very experienced underwater photographer. And he was looking up, and he was just kind of like, okay, Marty, now give me some space now. That's enough. You know, like he was trying to kind of like push a friendly dog away. And I laughed so hard that I flooded my dive mask with water immediately. It was very funny.
Hate when that happens. And when that does happen, Farm, and we find ourselves in that situation, what do you do?
When an animal approaches you?
Oh, when your mask completely floods up with water,
oh,
if you ever find
gotcha.
Yourself in that situation.
Yeah, so there is a particular way of what we call clearing your mask. So if you're ever snorkeling or diving and you get some, I'll demonstrate it for you. And you get some water in your mask and you feel like you're flooding like this, don't panic. You just press the mask like that. You look up to the surface and you blow out through your nose. And all of the water will be expelled underneath the mask and go out there. But if you're learning how to snorkel or dive, that will be included in your training as well.
Absolutely. And it kind of links into the next question there. What advice would you give to a newbie snorkeler? And the second part of it is, what animals are easy to spot for someone who's never really been snorkeling before? And I think the most important thing that I wanted to address first and foremost is that you have to make sure you go with someone who knows what they're doing at the same time. Make sure you go to an area, read the weather patterns as well. You shouldn't be going out during southerly winds if you know that it's prone to waves at going 50 kilometers per hour. You know that that's just nonsense. You need to make sure.
Too much adventure.
No one needs that amount of adventure in your life. You just need to make sure it's relatively flat on the surface so that the clarity is good. If you can't see any more than a couple of meters ahead of you, I generally don't go out into the water. That clarity is a really important factor for me as well, because there are such big animals that do bump into you occasionally in the bay. I've had a situation where one of those giant smooth stingrays accidentally bumped into me because we couldn't sense each other from even a couple of meters away. And it spooked me like there was no tomorrow. It's really startling.
Yeah, I swam into a pier pylon before because the visibility was bad and I just bumped into it. And I thought, oh, that's no good. And also, you know, there's no use going out when it's like that because you're not going to see any animals. It's not going to be enjoyable.
Yeah, exactly. You might see like one toadfish and that's it, but it's not really worth it at all. So the advice that I could give to any newbie snorkeler, if you are coming into it, do it with a dive company first, see how they do it and learn as much as you can from them. You can always ask us in the chat other features as well about where you might want to go. Fam gave an indication, you know, Jawbone and going down to Rye Pier as well, because they're quite quiet areas that are well protected by the winds and currents. So they're quite interesting areas, diverse ecologically. As for what beginners would see, if you were to go, say, off Jawbone Sanctuary right now, farm, what would you see?
Well, if I would go, if the visibility is good, then I would walk into the water, and I would start snorkeling. And the first thing I would see is, a rocky reef and seagrass beds. And if I look in between the stones and things like that and seagrass beds, you can actually see a lot of small creatures. That's why I like to go to Jawbone. So in Jawbone, you can see small, like all kinds of crabs and sea stars. There are many different species of sea stars in the bay that are really beautifully colored, but also all kinds of fish like snapper, sometimes big fish too, hey Ben, like morworm that can turn quite big.
Yeah, absolutely. I've seen snook before. That's just resting in the shallows. They get to almost a meter in length. They're just waiting there.
Yeah, it's really lovely there. And what you'll start to notice if you're snorkeling in different locations in the bay, you'll start to notice the different ecosystems that all have their unique species that live in those ecosystems. So it's really worth going to different spots, because a pier ecosystem is different from a seagrass ecosystem. And there are unique species of animals that live in all of those different locations. So you always see something new when you go to a new location. I would probably recommend Rye Pier for beginners, especially during low tide, because Rye Pier is, the water is often quite clear, and it is just a wonderful ecosystem where you can see not just fish, but also other creatures that are attached to the pier pylons. So you have these vertical pier pylons that are just overgrown with sponges and seaweeds in all kinds of different colors. And that is really lovely. It actually looks like a tropical coral reef, yeah, but it's made out of sponges. And that's a very beautiful thing to go and see. Also, what I like about Rye Pier is that there's often schools of fish that come in, especially in the spring, where you can see all the little baby fish that have just hatched and you're swimming through clouds of small baby fish. And my favorite bay resident also lives at Rye Pier, and that is the big Maori octopus. The big Maori octopus is huge. It has, I think the tentacles get up to like a meter or meter and a half, doesn't it, Ben? Like the really big females. And they are not that scared of people. So you can actually observe. I have in the past observed a Maori octopus just hunting around Rai Pier, and when she saw a crab on the pier pylon, she would just go on there and wrap all of her 8 tentacles around this big pier pylon and gobble up this crab. And she was completely undisturbed by me snorkeling there and watching her every move. And a lot of people know these octopuses as well, just like the stingrays, as individuals, and they'll go back there and go and see them and say hello and spend some time with them and observe their natural behavior.
I know that when I go into the water for the very first time in and around the areas that I tend to go diving and snorkeling at Beau Morris, you go through the weedy seagrass areas, like you said before, on the rocky platform. Every now and again, you'll see pot-bellied seahorses just clinging onto holdfasts from the bottom. And they've got this gorgeous yellow coloration, almost golden appearance to their body. There's porcupine fish, the kind that when they blow up, they get to the size of a basketball, and they're very ugly looking things, horrendous looking face, spikes all over their body, but they don't want anything to do with you whatsoever. Banjo sharks and fiddler rays in the shallows. I reckon you'd see a few of them in Jawbone as well, Farm.
Yeah. They're quite common there. Also in Ricketts Point Marine Sanctuary.
There's lots and lots of stingrays and stingarees. They're just the smaller variety of stingray, and they have a leaf-like appendage at the end of their tail instead of having a straight barb at the end of their tail as well. They're everywhere. They hide in the sands, and you can see them in almost every single dive. I would be shocked if you went into Port Phillip Bay and you said you couldn't see a stingray, because they are absolutely almost at pest levels, but they're gorgeous. They're not pests, but they're gorgeous.
Don't call them pests.
there's
another few questions in here. This one I would also like to ask you, actually. What actually made you interested in the ocean?
Yeah.
It's
a good question. And I think it comes back, and it's going to be weird. It's going to be a weird answer to this. It comes back to my love of dinosaurs. It really does, because I was like, as a kid, I was fixated with dinosaurs. I just thought they were the coolest, the terrible lizards, reigned supreme for 160 million years on this planet. They were the biggest, the baddest, the most terrifying things that had ever lived. And I thought, wow, that's so cool. But then I started to realize that those big, terrifying, awesome predators also existed in a modern environment. And there was one thing in particular that always blows my mind. It was the size of a whale. And not many people can really appreciate just how big a whale can get, because not many people have seen the absolute biggest whale in the world. It's the blue whale. And I remember when I was in year 8, I was one of those really annoying kids that would ask a lot of questions, Farm. Like, I would not shut up.
Guilty.
Yeah.
That's why we're here today.
Like, sir, what happens if I do this? That kind of nonsense. Anyway, and I remember asking him a question. I was like, sir, what's the biggest animal that's ever lived? And we happened to be on the basketball court at the time. And he said, Ben, run down the basketball court and come back. And I'm like, sir, I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything wrong. He's just like, just trust me. Just run down the basketball court, come back, and I'll give you an answer to your question about the biggest animal that's ever lived. So I did it, 30 meters down, 30 meters back. I said, why'd you make me do that? And he said, Ben, blue whale is the biggest animal that's ever existed on the planet, 30 meters in length. And we still know so very little about them. And it just blew my mind to think that there was a creature that weighed the same as 30 African elephants that still lives on the planet today. So many animals we still have absolutely no idea about. There was a 6-meter long beaked whale that was described for the very first time in 2019. So we're on the frontier of discovery when it comes to the ocean. It is constantly exciting. The things that we're finding are things that no one has ever seen before. And some of the animals are still massive in their own right. So Farm, I'm gonna ask you the exact reverse of that question. What made you interested in the ocean?
Well, I've always, I started, you know, when I was in high school, I was like you, Ben. I was always asking so many questions. And
so
it was
many
mostly
annoying questions for me.
Very annoying.
We're just like, ugh.
But I was always asking them about nature. because that was what fascinated me the most. So, you know, I started as a kid asking my mother, why this, why that, why is that bird there? What is it doing? All that kind of stuff. And my mom couldn't answer that. And I did the same with my biology teacher in high school. And so they proposed to me, well, maybe you should study biology so you can learn how to answer your own questions. So that's what I did. And I was studying biology at uni already. And I was in my first year. And my mother said, to motivate me, she said, if you ace all of your exams of your first year at uni all in one go in the first year, I will pay for you to get your first dive certificate, your scuba dive certificate. And man, that was all the motivation I needed, obviously, because I'd been snorkeling since I was 6 years old. So I'd already spent a little bit of time underwater. I'd been very lucky to be able to travel to places that had coral reefs. So I had done some diving or some snorkeling on coral reefs already and really loving it and having a hard time staying out of the water when I was in those places. So yeah, the offer of a dive course on the table obviously motivated me very much. And so I did that, aced all of my exams and did my dive course. And I remember the first time I was actually down on a coral reef diving and not just being floating on the surface as a snorkeler or as a visitor, but being amongst the fish and them being so unperturbed by my presence, and then looking at a coral reef and thinking, I have just spent an entire year learning about living things at university, and I have no idea what a coral is. Is it a stone? Is it a plant? Is it an animal? What the hell am I looking at? And I was so fascinated by that. I saw creatures under the water that were so oddly shaped. They look like plants, but they're actually animals. I've seen animals there that are just the weirdest things that you might see, you know, in science fiction films. And I have seen, you know, animals that look like plants and plants that look like animals, and it just didn't make sense to me. And that's where my fascination with the oceans came from, because I thought, if that stuff lives just right there beneath the surface, I will be able to ask all of my questions for the rest of my life and I'll be perfectly happy discovering all the answers.
Yeah, I know that feeling completely, Farm, when it comes to just looking at every single different microcosm. You can look at the macrocosm and you can see a blue whale, but then you look at something like a sea squirt and somebody tells you, hey, Ben, a sea squirt is an animal, lives and breathes, but it just looks like a rock. And the more you start to understand about its anatomy, the even stranger facets of it become to you. I mean, a sea squirt in particular is just so remarkable, because here is an animal that when it's born, the eggs and the fuse form into a zygote and starts off into the world. It has a primitive brain, a notochord. It swims through the water like a little tadpole. But then sometime throughout its metamorphosis into an adult, it decides to itself, you know what? I am sick of swimming. I'm just going to settle on the bottom of the seafloor and never move again. And so what it does just basically pupates, like how a caterpillar turns into a butterfly and rearranges a lot of its internal bodywork, but in doing so gets rid of that primitive brain and backbone and all the other features that made it look like an animal to make it look like a rock. And it's just wild, isn't it?
And some of them look like a vase that you would put a bunch of flowers in. They look like they're made out of glass with a tube at the top. Like, they're just incredible creatures. So yeah, the fascination with all of the stuff that lives down there just never ends. And that's how I like it.
Me too, Farm. Well, look, thank you so much for joining us today. I can't tell you how much fun I always have with you whenever we do these. It's always great. So I'd like to thank each and every single one of you for tuning in today and watching and giving us those great questions just before. I just want to say that the webinar will be recorded on EcoCentre's YouTube channel, EcoCentre TV. And if you are interested in this event, well, I'm going to be holding another one tomorrow afternoon. You can come and join me again. You can ask me any question you want. It can be about sharks. It can be about sea squirts eating their brains. You name it. We've got more events throughout the next few days. Go to ecocentre.com/CNF 2020. 2021. Thank you, Reiko, who has been a fantastic tech supervisor throughout this entire time as well. Thank you all, and we hope to see you again soon. Thanks so much.
Bye, everyone. It was really great to have you here.